You're about to listen to a message by Reverend Yomi Kasali of Foundation of Truth Assembly. May the word you hear bear fruit in your heart, now and always.
I'll read from verse number 39. I'll be speaking on the subject of addictions today. Addictions. I will speak about seven signs of addiction and seven negative addictions that can be destroy lives. Seven negative addictions. But let me go to John's Gospel, the 11th chapter, verse 39. Jesus said, "Take ye away the stone." You know the story, don't you? Lazarus was dead. Jesus went there, wanted to raise the dead. And the first thing he did was that, for me to raise the dead, we've got to carry the stone away. So he said, "Take ye away the stone." Martha, the sister of him that was dead, said to him, "Lord, by this time it stinketh, for he has been dead 4 days." 4 days. Next verse. Jesus said to her, "Said I not unto thee that if you would believe, you will see the glory of God?" Somebody say, "Believe." Shout, "Believe." Say, "You will see the glory." If you would believe, you will see the glory of God. Next verse. Then they took away the stone from the place where the dead was laid. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that thou hearest me always, but because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they may believe that thou hast sent me." Next verse. And when he had thus spoken, he cried with a loud voice, "Lazarus, come forth. Come forth." And he that was dead came forth miraculously. Verse 44 is a verse of emphasis today. He that was dead came forth, bound hand and foot. He came forth, bound. He came alive, bound, with grave clothes. And his face was bound about with a napkin. So Jesus now said to them, "Loose him and let him go." Loose him and let him go. Father, we thank you for today. We ask you will help us to understand our role and your role in setting men free. In Jesus' name. Put your hands together as you have your seat in God's presence. Loose him and let him go. Many years ago, I fell in love with that scripture and I used it in a crusade ground. There are two things that happen there. You find Jesus saying, "Come forth." And he that was dead came forth. He that was dead came forth. So you can paraphrase by saying they became born again. Though I am alive, I'm still bound. Though I'm saved, I'm still bound. He that was dead came alive, walked but bound. Bound. So the anointing brought him back to life, but there was something the anointing could not do. So even Jesus needed help to finish the work of deliverance. Jesus needed assistance. So he said, "You now lose him. I've done what I can do. I've brought him back to life. You cannot bring him back to life. I've brought him back to life. But I, the anointing, cannot lose him. You have to now do something physically, through counseling, through support, to set him free. He's alive, but he's bound. He's saved, but he's bound. He's born again, but he's bound. He loves me, but he's bound. goes to church but is bound. He's walking but bound. His face cannot be seen. Truly, 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 he's saved. He's alive in the spirit, but bound in the flesh. So we try to explain what God and how God works with men. There are so many men that are saved, yet bound by the yoke of afflictions and addictions. Bound. Though they are born again, they love the Lord, they speak in tongues, they sing in a choir, they worship with us, but they are still bound. And so you begin to wonder, how can I help further? God will expect you and expect me to do our own roles to set them free totally. The work of salvation is not complete until they can walk without grave clothes. There are so many of us that are bound today with grave clothes, addiction clothes, and we struggle, we cry, we yell, we scream, we pray, and we're saying, I wish I can walk freely. I'm not totally delivered. I wish I can walk freely. I'm bound. I wish you can tell. I don't know if you can see me. I wish I could be free totally. I'm bound. I'm bound. Though I'm saved, I carry the life of God in me, but I'm still bound. So that's where addictions come in today. And I found out that this is something we shy away from, and we need to confront it headlong. It's a very sensitive subject. Addictions. Addictions. And I want to be very honest with you today to let you know, many Christians are indeed addicted to certain things that they do that they would love to be free from. They're addicted. And I'm saying, Pastor, I know I'm saved, yet bound. Can you help me? And you and I need to do, lose him and let him go. We need to help them. And I don't want to approach the subject today from scientific perspective. I don't want to. Else I'll be speaking the language that will confuse you, that will confuse me as well. Because I'm not a scientist. I've read a bit about it. I know about it. I don't know how dopamine works. I don't want to tell you how it works in the brain, how it influences you, how you fuel or feed your dopamine. And when it drops down, you want to go back to, I don't want to approach. I don't want to go that route. Let me stay in an area I am comfortable with, scripture. I don't want to approach it from a psychological perspective. I'm not a psychologist, yes? You have done some courses around it. And I'm not an expert in that area. I'm not an expert to tell you how the mind works with the subject of addiction, the things you are addicted to, how your mind feels that I cannot survive without it. I don't want to go to that place. Please, let me stay in an area I am comfortable with. Is that okay? Let me stay in this realm of the spirit. Sir, is it spiritual? Oh, yes, it is. Everything on earth is both natural and spiritual. I know you can debate that. It's spiritual. You find it from scriptures. So I'm going to give you like 5 to 10 passages in scriptures to try to explain to you what it's all about. And to do that, let me attempt to give you my layman definition of the word addiction. Many years ago, I preached this sermon. Many. And I said, afflictions and addictions, because people don't know the connection between the afflictions of man and addictions of man. Some of us are afflicted because we are addicted and we don't know it. And I tried to connect your affliction not just to Satan's scourge on you, but your own addictions as well. And so those afflictions come because you're actually addicted. And if you can break the addictions, you will find you'll be free from those afflictions. And the power of God is existing to help us break the hold of addictions. People don't believe that, but there's something called the power of God. It's called the anointing. It's called there's nothing God cannot do. It's called the anointing. Some may take you to a hospital, may take you elsewhere, but you still feel addicted. Go try God's power. There's no yoke the power of God cannot destroy. No yoke on earth. No yoke that God's power cannot destroy. No yoke, no yoke. Either the yoke you placed on yourself or the yoke placed on you by the devil. The power of God can destroy yokes. It's called the anointing. Somebody shout yes. You can't tell me no. This one cannot be broken by the power of God. Who told you that? Who told you that? So let's try to define what I call addiction. Now, this is what you call a deliverance service. And people don't understand what deliverance means. They think it's always you shouting, screaming, yelling, and going to a mountaintop and rolling on the floor. Oh no, you can be free today without you making a noise. And you walk away from this house, though you came here with yokes of addiction, and you walk free and at liberty. Put your hands together for Jesus. You will be free in the name of Jesus. You will be free in Jesus' name. Addictions have caused many problems: financial problems, family problems, health problems, suicide issues, relationship problems. You need to be delivered. It's a yoke. It's a yoke placed on you. You carry it around. Let me try to define addiction. In my note, I say it's the state of being enslaved to a habit. Key word is enslaved. Enslaved to a habit. You're in a state where you feel bound. Habit is what you do uncontrollably. It could be a pleasure. You just find yourself doing it every now and then, and you can't control yourself anymore. It's controlling you now. It's in charge, not you. So we call addiction when you practice something and you do something habitually, compulsive behavior that is beyond you. You can't understand why that thing's got a hold on you. It's got a hold on you. You get to the point where you don't believe you can survive without doing it. You don't think you can live without doing it. That thing begins to feed you, fuel you. That it gives you the sense of joy, pleasure, and success. If you don't do it, you feel you're sick. Check those that are under the burden of drug addiction. They just keep running to the place. They will sell their mother's house, their father's savings, just to sniff that powder called coke. I've seen people destroyed. I've seen lives destroyed. Those close to me, very close to me. My late father was an addicted, my own late father. He sent me when I was much younger to go and be buying what they call pool, you know, called pool. Those are what you call sport betting today. It was called pool then. My dad could not do without it one day, one week. He will make money from office. When I go and do it, he will keep playing and they will nap. He almost got me involved in that nonsense. I kept going week in, week out. He just had to do it. My own brother, for 30 years, is addicted to drugs. Addicted. He just can't break off. I had to travel thousands of miles to see him one day. I said, look at your life. You're finished. You're ruined. You quoted scripture to me in verse. Those days, you are a scripture walking man. There was no passage in Bible you didn't know. You inspired me to be saved. Look at you today. As I was talking yet, every word he spread out of his mouth was scripture. He was saying, my God, Bible says, shut up. Stop saying the Bible says. When you are doing this, how come the Bible says? Bible says. He was still quoting scripture. Ruined his marriage. His wife walked out. Destroyed his son. His son said, dad, don't come anymore. All of us have abandoned him. He still keeps calling you. Lives on the street. Says, Yomi, please send me 50 euro. Send me $100. I need to. I said, no. I won't feed that monster anymore. You are addicted and afflicted. Break it. Stop this nonsense. Break it. Today he has nobody around him anymore. My dad the same. My dad went to the second wife, third wife, fourth wife, fifth wife, sixth wife. Terrible habit destroyed him. Lost his business, lost his life, sold everything he had just because he wanted to make big money. I can make it again. I'll try again. Dad, stop this nonsense. He was 74, 75. I sat down with him. Dad, you've got to stop this. No, don't do it anymore. But dad, look at this. This is all those documents, pool paper. No, it was there mistakenly. Kept doing it. Kept going there. Something drives it. Something is a yoke. It's a yoke. You ask yourself, how can I free myself? The power of God is here today to set you free. Put your hands together for Jesus. Habits are things that we do and enjoy doing without thinking twice. Those things can be negative or positive. I have an habit. When I wake up in the morning, I say, thank you, Jesus. I like the habit. Thank you, Jesus. I speak in tongues habitually. I like that habit. It can be positive, it can be negative. Is that clear? So you have to understand that. But it can also have a hold on us to the point that we become its slaves. The key word today is don't lose control. Tell somebody, don't lose control. Say it again, say, don't lose control. The moment anything controls you, that thing holds you. The moment anything controls you, that thing owns you. You are a slave to the things that control you. You are a slave. Once it controls you, you are no more in charge. That thing owns your life, owns your money, owns your thinking, owns your mind, owns everything that you have, owns your very essence, owns your job. You work for the thing, doesn't work for you. So let me give you some Bible passages before I go to the seven signs that you're addicted. Then I'll tell you the seven negative addictions that we must run from. Bible tells us in Hebrews chapter 12, because I want to go to the Bible, like I said, so I can show you scriptures to aid you, to support you, to know which scripture to quote if you want to be free, that we should run the race. This was Hebrews 12 verse 1. Give me Hebrews 12 verse 1. Seeing the cloud of witnesses. In other words, in Hebrews 11, he showed us all those that lived and fought battles for God and with God, and they succeeded. In chapter 12, it said, wherefore, seeing also you are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, all these guys, Abraham, Joseph, Moses, Samson, all these great heroes of faith, let us lay aside every weight. That's where I'm going. And the sin which so easily beset us. That's addiction. That's something you easily do. Some call it weight, some call it sin. Some don't want to link addiction to sin. I will show you today that it's a sin. I will show you for every habit that you do, there is an underlying sin fueling that habit. I will show you. Easily beset us. The weight means you are under that yoke. You are a Christian running the race, but there's a heavy weight on you. You wish you could take the load off your neck, but it's there. Every weight, and sin that easily beset us. Easily besetting sins, they call them. Besetting weights, they call them. It's called habits. That's what he meant there. Saying there's some habits that you're under. Hey, put them aside if you're going to be a Christian. You won't be able to run with those habits. You can't run this race with those habits around you. That's why Jesus said in Matthew 11 verse 28, come unto me all you that labor and are heavy laden, heavy yoked, heavily yoked. There's so much you're carrying. In fact, the person that speaks so much about addiction is the Apostle Paul himself. And if this scripture is a scripture we've used several times to teach and preach about how you can struggle with sin, but not just sin, with some habits. Romans chapter 7 verse number 14. And that's what he said. Paul the apostle was defining the wretched man. Tell somebody, wretched man. Say it against a wretched man. He said, for we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin. I am carnal, I'm human. But the law of God, the word of God is spiritual. Look at the next verse. How do we know that? The reason we know it is that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, what I want to do, that I do not. But what I hate, that do I don't want this porn addiction. I don't want this bet addiction. I don't like this gambling addiction. But I hate it, but I do it. That which I hate, that I do. Have you been there before? When you know in your heart that I don't want to do this, but you find yourself doing it. You know why? You're no longer yours. It controls you. Next verse. That thing is controlling you. There are so many people under different yokes of addiction. If then I, watch me, if I do that which I do not want to do, I agree to the law that the law of God is good. Oh God, help me. Oh God, help me. I'm in trouble. Now then, watch me, it is no more I that do it, but what? Can I hear you shout it, but what? I, by grace, preachers don't like this, but what? Sin that dwelleth in me. How dare you say once you're born again, you can't sin anymore. Apostle Paul, acknowledge that sin dwelleth in me. And you are saying, no, you cannot sin. I had one preacher on Twitter or two or TikTok yesterday was trying to explain Book of Life, and the man confused himself. These people, I don't know where they came from. All these modern day young preachers who are untrained in the word. Do you think the scripture is something you can teach without being trained? Study to show yourself approved of God so that you can rightly divide the word. The man said, the Book of Life, that God did not write it. There's nowhere in the Bible where God wrote Book of Life. That everybody living, God put everybody's name there. All everybody, Muslim, Hindu, Shintoism, born again, dead again. God put all of us name there. That is the person that rejects Christ, God will now remove their name from the Book of Life. I said, even what he's saying does not make sense. So I don't need to accept Christ for my name to be there. But I need to reject Christ. Okay, I reject him. But okay. I'm not going to reject him. But I will not accept him. For my name is there. So he says salvation is eternal. How can there still be salvation when you put all our names there? Ab initio, from when I was one day old, my name is there. So that means I don't need to be saved because my name is... I don't get it. Some things I don't get. Go to Bible school, they refuse. Because, listen, this is the problem we have. Listen to me. And I was struggling with the Holy Ghost. I said, Lord, how do I explain to people? Watch me. How do I explain that the fact that you are anointed does not mean you don't need training? That's the issue. The fact that you are called at age 10, 11, nobody is doubting the call of God is on your life. I'm not doubting. The word anointing means the presence of God on you to enable you to do some things with his help. Does that mean I don't need training? Because we magnify the anointing above training. Do you get the point? I'm anointed. I'm not doubting it. I'm called. Are you trained? I don't need training. Search scriptures. Jesus at 12 went to the temple to be trained. The Son of God sitting with doctors of the law discussing scriptures. Tell me, am I right? Apostle Paul, Galatians 1, said, all the insight God gave to me, by the way, God called me. I submitted my revelation to the apostles before me. Come and listen to what I'm teaching, lest I have run in vain. Paul used the word, I don't want to have run in vain. Am I teaching what is right? They told me, okay, we've looked at it. What you are teaching is right. Take the right hand of fellowship, go and teach it. Training. Do you get the difference? Nobody is doubting you have a call upon your life. I'm just saying, train yourself. Educate your mind. Sit under those that are anointed. Elisha was called by God to go and do it, succeed Elijah. He still went to training under the Elijah. He washed his hand. He served him. Teach me this. I have the call. I'm supposed to be the one succeeding you. But please, train me. We have school of the prophets, sons of the prophets, plenty sons of the prophet. Don't let me go into it. Because what we're doing is we're magnifying oratory skills, oratory prowess for the anointing. You can be a great speaker and speak for the devil and speak for the flesh. People don't know it. And it pains me. It pains me. Herod in Acts chapter 12 was a great orator. When he finished speaking, he said, the voice of the gods have been heard. Heavenly God gave him a slap. Acts 12, a slap, a dirty slap. The man became worms. She, the other woman became pillar of salt. He became a worm. For he did not give glory to God. So where were we before they distracted us? Those people that said, there's no sin in me. Go back to Romans 7. Give me Romans 7. He said, I testify that what? Sin in me. Addictions. Romans 7, give it to me. So he now says, for I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not. This is a person struggling with a particular sin, besetting sin. I want to do this. I find myself not doing it. The things I don't want to do, I find myself doing. Actually, I don't like this. So he says, so I know, look at the next verse. I know that in me, for the good that I would do, I do not. But the evil which I would not, that I do. The things I don't want to do, I find myself doing. I'm struggling. Can somebody help me, please? Now, if I do that I don't want to do, it is no more I that do it, but sin dwelleth in me. Second time. So I can sin be controlling me. I see Paul struggle. Yeah, this is Paul struggling with the flesh. Next verse, quickly. I find then a law that when I will do good, every time I want to do something great, evil is present also around me, because my flesh is always there when I want to do something. So see that evil as one man dressed in black, always around you, trying to give you a knock. When you want to do what is right, say no, you must do mine. So that I'm being torn, I'm being pulled into 2-3 different places. I want to do right, I find myself doing bad. I ate bad, I don't have strength to stop doing bad. I wish I could break and not do this anymore, but I find myself going to the things I hate, actually hate them. I'm struggling. I find myself, what I want to do, I'm not doing that which I don't want to do. I find myself doing it. This owns me. Next verse. So it looks like I'm a slave to this. I'm a slave. There's so many great slaves here. Tongue talking slaves. I delight to do the law of God in my inner man. Look at the next verse. This guy is struggling, man. But I see another law in my members warring against the law of my mind and bringing me to one. Say it again. Let me hear you. Slavery. I'm bound. Captivity means I'm bound. I'm under the yoke. I'm under the yoke of addiction. Captivity to the law of sin, which is my members. That thing is holding me like handcuff. I don't want to do it. Look, who help me? Oh, wretched man that I am. Who shall deliver me from this body of death? For it says, thanks be to God. I thank God through Jesus Christ. So then with my mind, I serve the law of God. With my flesh, I serve the law of sin. So you see here, Paul explaining his struggle with something that he had that weighed him down. We don't know what it was. For yours, it could be an addiction. It could be something that you don't want to do and you find yourself doing it. And you know what I'm talking about, don't you? Wretched man. We're all wretched somehow. A man, Proverbs tells us about addiction. Proverbs 25 verse 28. I like it so very much. Because addiction is about what? Control. Somebody shout control. Don't forget that's what I'm going to say. Control. If you're not in control, you're addicted. He that has no rule, no control over his own spirit is like a what? A city that is broken down and without walls. Defenseless. So everything can come in. If you see a city without walls, everything can come in. It's like a city. Why? He that cannot rule, cannot control, not just his thinking, his mind, control himself, control in spirit. Some say this is just anger. It's not just anger. To be able to control, you must be in control with the help of God. You must be. You have to be. You have to be. You have to be. This is very important. He that has self-control is better than the one that takes the city. Proverbs 16 verse 32. Can you imagine? It says, if you have self-control, you can control yourself. You're better than the man that takes the city. Proverbs 16, understanding is a wellspring. Verse 23 is there. No, you got it wrong. 32. Proverbs 16, 32. If you can control it, then you are like a man greater than one that is sitting. He that is slow to anger is better than the mighty. He that ruleth his own spirit, that is in control, than he that takes a city. Saul almost killed his own son. Saul. Bible says, be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners. 1 Corinthians 15, 33. So if you have friends that help you through your addiction, cut off from them. When I give people a 21-day test, I tell them, if you want to break off any addiction, habits are formed within 21 days. Habits are broken in 21 days. They are both formed and broken in 21 days. Formed and broken in 21 days. So if you can try not to work with those that help you, evil communication corrupt good manners. You will become one. Break off from them. Then you become free. Addictions. I like the way Paul puts it in 1 Corinthians 6 verse 12. 1 Corinthians 6 verse 12 is very important. This is the subject. All things are lawful, but not all things are helpful. Why? For all things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power. Power addiction. My late father, like I said to you, was addicted to playing gambling. What's it called? Betting, sport betting. My dad just liked it. It was called pool those days. My late father also had another addiction, alcoholism. My dad just kept drinking and kept drinking. And I can drink small, but be careful not to be brought under the power of alcohol. I will not be brought under the power of henny. That's what he's saying there. All things are lawful. Don't let us debate it. But be careful how you become enslaved by it, to your own pleasures. I will not be brought under the power, meaning I will not be under the addiction. To be brought under the power means you are no more in control. The thing is now controlling you. That's why Paul said in Ephesians 5, be not drunk with wine when there is excess, but be filled with the Holy Ghost. That's a positive addiction. Let the Holy Ghost control you, not wine. Be filled with the Holy Ghost. Let the Holy Ghost control you. Let him be the one telling you to move, to speak, to do this. I'm under, I'm intoxicated by the Holy Ghost. I can make it like a boshata. You lay and let the Holy Ghost control you. Let him control you. That's what Paul said. For Paul to be comparing the Holy Ghost with wine, says to be not drunk. Don't be under the power of alcohol. Don't be under the control. Don't be addicted to alcohol. Don't be addicted. Have you seen good, great men? My late mother used to call alcoholism addiction. He used the name for it in Yoruba. He says, Abuaje, Lokota and Poti. The day he sat with me, he said, son, don't you ever drink. Abuaje, look at your father. Meaning, alcohol will destroy your character. Iwa means character. Uma baje. You see a good man naked on the street. Why? Alcohol. Because when he is drunk, you'll be naked. Following day, you tell them, do you know you drank? Me. You were naked. Me naked. You were naked. Alcohol. The day I feared alcohol more was the day my father brought out his double barrel. My dad had two guns. He was drunk. My brother was fighting him. He brought out his double barrel and he shot at his own son. No, she can look close. The boy, he didn't hit him. He missed. Following day, we told him, he said, it's not possible. Daddy, there was no video, there was no phone. You shot, this is not possible. How can I shoot at my son? Daddy, you shot at your own son. He said, it's not possible, don't lie to me. You shot at your son. You almost killed your son. He said, it's not possible. You didn't agree. People on the street came, Alaji, we saw you, we were begging you, you shot. You bala, no, you just shot. I'm telling you. Remember Marvin Gaye's story? Imagine if the boy had been hit and the boy had been killed. Following day, that call will come down. Abuaje, look at that, body. Under the control, you can't control it. They just drink with the stupor. You lose your senses, you can't even think straight. The thing begins to control you. You strip yourself naked, you sleep in the gutter. Gutter water looks like air conditioner. They will carry you, bring you out, and say, hey, did I do that? Yes, sir, you did it. Have you seen people that are drunk before? Have you seen them? What they do, they don't know. Addiction. Following them, they will go and do it again. All things are lawful. I will not be brought under the power of any. Meaning, I'll be in control. I'll be in control. Be careful not to lose control. Tell somebody, don't lose control. Say, don't lose control. Addiction. Addiction. Because we are all slaves with pleasure. Addiction makes you a slave with what? Pleasure. Slave with pleasure. To him that knows how to do good and do it not to him is a sin. James 4:17. Paul said to us in Galatians 5 verse 1, stand fast in the liberty of Christ and do not be yoked again into slavery. Don't bring yourself into slavery. Don't be slave to anything. Don't you do that. No substance, no habit. Don't become a slave to a habit. It's called addiction. We're going to break it today. We're going to ask God's power. We're going to sing that song, break every chain, break every chain. We're going to ask God to break every chain in the name of Jesus. You're going to stand in the gap for your brother, your sister, your cousin, your aunt, your uncle, your dad, your mom, whoever you think is on that you know. You will stand in the gap and say, Lord, let your power hit that person and set him free. Set her free. Lose him and let him go. Lose him and let him go. Addiction. The devil knows how to destroy lives. He's come to steal, to kill, and to destroy. This is one way he destroys. Addiction. Addiction. You become afflicted because you're addicted. Addiction. Addiction. Very important for you to understand that. Do not ever stay under the yoke of addiction. I mean, Paul the apostle used the word positively. Don't forget, I told you what you do habitually, that you lose control. In 1 Corinthians 16, verse 15, he spoke about the house of Stephanas. They were addicted to the ministry of the saints. I like it. That's the only word used in the New Testament. Addicted. You see, I beseech you, brethren, you know the house of Yomi Kasali, you know the house of Shoyibos, the house of Alakas, that it is the first fruit of care, and that they have addicted themselves. Those guys just couldn't do anything but to serve the saints. They uncontrollably, they just love the saints. They love God's work. Addicted themselves to the ministry of the saints. It's what you do uncontrollably. You just couldn't stop it. If I would be addicted at all, I'd be addicted to something good, to God's work. You see that guy? You can't stop him. If you try it, he just everything is church. God's work. He's addicted to the things of God. He's hooked onto the things of God. Addiction. All of us have things that we like and we do. That's why I call them addiction. Let me share with you quickly, because of my time, 7 signs that you're addicted. You may just be addicted and not know. 7 signs that you're what? Addicted. And I will tell you the 7 negative things that people are addicted to. Maybe I should even mention them first. 7 signs. I want to go through it. Number 1, when you lose control and the thing controls you, it is killing you softly and you are not in control again. Anything that controls you, you are addicted to. You lose control, the thing controls you. You are no more in control. Sometimes you want to break it off, but you just can't control yourself. You wish it won't be there. You wish you could stop it, but you can't. Tell somebody, don't lose control. Shout, don't lose control. Say it again, say, don't lose control. You must be in charge. You must control. When God created man, he created us to dominate, to have dominion, to be in charge. Anything that controls you is not godly. If anything controls your impulses, your faculties, your thinking, your life, your mind, your physicality, everything that controls you, you are a slave to. Don't you ever lose control. It's not right. Don't lose control. Number 2, when you no longer enjoy what controls you, even though you once derived pleasure from it. You once derived pleasure from it. But today, you no longer. You know, start by saying, let me just take a glass of alcohol. I went to a cruise with my wife. And the family is my best friend in the family. They're my wife and I, the best couple that we have. In Houston, Obina Umweke and myself, we're very close. So we went on a cruise, both families, we're just enjoying ourselves. So the second day, Obina said, hey, Pastor, say the Catholics and Pentecostal, let me just go to the casino. I said, which casino? He said, they have a casino here. I said, what are you going to do there? He said, me, I only go to those places more small. I'm in control. It's just $20. I go, my brother is addicted, but me, I'm not addicted. I just go there, play casino, $20. I said, you sure this 20 will not become 200? He said, no. He said, Matthew, I am in control. Ask my wife. The wife was there. But it's true. The wife told me, whenever he goes, he says, I want to go and spend $20. He never spends more than 20. I said, okay, have you earned more? He said, yes, sir. Sometimes I play, I hit jackpot. I make maybe 500. I said, what do you do with it? I said, what? They're doing it. I mean, 2 hours time, I mean. I said, what do you do with it? I said, what do you do with it? He said, I plow it back. Watch me. Once in a while, he makes the money, 600, 1,000. I said, fantastic. What do you do when you make that money? He said, I plow it back. I went there with a man of 220, and I don't do 120. I said, I know, when you do this 20, and you make 500, 800, do you take it home? I said, maybe once or twice, but I plow it back. When you're plowing it back, why are you plowing back? To hope to make more, right? Okay, if you make more, What do you do with it again? You plant it back. To do what again? To make more. And then you do what? Until you lose it all. And then you go home and say, I'm happy. I went with 20. I didn't lose 20. No, I gained 1,000. I lost 1,000. So I said to him, trust your pastor. Open now. Don't be my thing. I beg you. Go. Go your own. I didn't go with him. He went. I said, open now. Don't be my thing. I know if you do him. I know Sabiam. I don't want to do him. I don't want to do him. I said, I don't want to know. I don't want to do. I don't want Sabi. Go do him yourself. He went. I went. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to just sit and listen to music. Enjoy myself. You go and do $20. So, actually, what he told me, and I asked his wife said, he's in control. That is his brother that is out of control. That this man goes every day 20, 30. In my mind, what if your wife does not know you're doing 50, 60, 80? I wonder, but he's in control. But at that point, he's in control. But I became afraid because the thing is now controlling you that you must do it. It's controlling you. You think you're in control of how much you put in, but it's controlling that you must do. So if I start by controlling you that you must do, after a while, you must do more. After a while, you must do much more. Then you must do a lot, much more. Be in control. The moment you lose control, you've lost it. Anything, that's what Romans chapter 6 says to us about sin. Anything that controls you, owns you. You are a slave to. Don't you ever forget that. Addiction is about slavery. Listen to me. Choose who becomes your master. It's your choice. If I'll be a slave, let me be a slave with a choice. And I choose Jesus. Put your hands together to be my master. I will not choose something else that will ruin and damage my life. Number three, withdraw us from loved ones and family because of the addictive compulsive behavior. Now, it's a sign. If you see people that always withdraw from loved ones, family people, they're always hiding in secret, they have an addiction. You don't want you to know. Addicted to this, addicted to that. We went to a conference in Dallas. I told you the story. An international pastor's conference in Dallas. And then that day, my boy, Alade Frasin called me and said, Yomi, do you know what he just told us? I said, no. All of us were pastors and apostles. He said, he just told us now that they are concerned that pornography sites shoot high in the whole year during our week conference. You don't get it. When we all come there. Now that is when visits to pornography sites spikes. The hotel management told us. So, when Pastor Ali told me, I said, which horse? He said, all of us, apostles and pastors. So, Emeka, so they are concerned. They now told us, come, how come we know the rate of pornographic visits? But it's when these apostles and pastors come here. When he told me, I said, we should be ashamed though. So, God forgive me. The following night, we were all there looking, doing hearing the word. I kept looking at them. Look at them. God forgive me. God forgive me. God forgive me. Because I sat there, people are teaching the word. I'm like, who are those doing it? Are these stupid fools? I was distracted. Because that information distracted me. And I sat there, and I look at these great apostles, all of us. So we are the ones beginning this to go up, all of us here. Hey, Jehovah. Now, I was shocked. Addiction. The thing is in control. Withdraw from loved ones. When you withdraw from loved ones, it shows you're addicted. Number four, when you regret what you do uncontrollably, people that are addicted usually regret. They regret it, but they won't tell you. They're not happy. They're like, oh God, how do I break this? Because it's damaging their families, their loved ones, ruining their finances, taking their joy away from them, and they are regretting it. So they're like, how do I break off? How do I stop this? How do I stop this? There are many things people are addicted to. Don't just not just gambling, pornography. I don't know about women. I don't know what they are addicted to. That is negative. That is destroying you. That is destroying your life. And you cannot control it. It haunts you. Controls you. Better break it. Stop it. Tell God to help you. Habitual, number five, habitual lying to family and loved ones because of shame and secrecy. When you begin to lie, where did you say, I went to the market? You lie. It shows that you didn't go to any market. You just keep lying. You just keep lying because you're ashamed of what you're going through. You're ashamed and secrecy. Whatever you do regularly and you cannot, in the dark, and you cannot tell people in the light, sin. Whatever you do in the dark, meaning that when nobody's there, and you cannot tell somebody else in the light, that you're ashamed of sharing with, do you know last week I was alone, I did this, that you cannot share. Not as a testimony, but as just what you do. You're ashamed of it, it becomes a secret, it's a sin. Addiction, you're addicted to it, you can't stop it. You cannot share it. You cannot come to the altar to say testimony time, testimony. Praise the Lord. When everybody is in church, and when I'm alone, this is what I do. You cannot share it as a testimony. You're laughing. That's how you know the signs that you are addicted. Number six, loss of money and selling of possessions to fund dangerous addictive habits. This means unpredictable spending culture. I'm telling you from my own life. My brother, my father, my late father spent everything he had, sold cars, he had sold on his cars to fuel his addiction. Then he was broke at some point, but kept selling. He couldn't just stop it. My brother sold everything he had. If you give him that money today, he will go and feed and fuel his addiction, his habit. And that thing does nothing but destroy you further. Destroys you further. It's not helping you. It's destroying you, but you keep fueling it. You keep funding it. Addiction. And you're afflicted. You're afflicted. If you know what this sport betting has done to people. Hey! I used to have a staff in our church. It's staff. A staff that is a low staff. When they came to, they chased him here. People came to look for him in church. They came in groves. What is happening? This church. Hey, this man is owing us. He's owing us this. I said, I called him. He said, I don't know. I'm addicted. He said, stop betting. I know one day I will make it. So we told him, we will break it off you. We pray for him. We broke the power. Okay, we'll help you pay off all those huge debts. Times 10 of his salary, we paid it off. Said, from today, no more. 2 months after, another case came. I said, but you don't do no more. It's just one time. One time. One time, many times. So I said, look, a man like this will sell everything in church. I said, this man will come one day, you won't see camera. You come one day. I said, okay, no, before you sell my, because addiction is, you are sacked. He paid me. I said, no, I said, I love you, but I love myself more. But you will soon sell it. You sell me, in fact. Addiction. Addiction. They will sell everything. Addiction. I fired him to preserve my life and my sanity. You sell off things. Number seven. Changes in mood through mood swings. Someone becomes an emotional wreck at home and around. So that's a sign. If someone that's always having mood swing, unhappy, sad, you don't know why. Are you okay? I'm okay. Are you okay? Your wife is addicted to something. Find out. Just do know they're addicted to something that they're hiding, they're running, they're withdrawing. There's an addiction. They can't tell you, they can't share it, they can't open up because they're ashamed of it. I'm not proud of it. I'd rather withdraw, and I'm ashamed. My mood is always changing. It's a sign that something is wrong. Let me in 2-3 minutes tell you the 7 types of addiction that is very dangerous. 7 types of addiction that can destroy lives. There are many more. Don't forget, it's about control. Don't lose control. Anything you do, all things are lawful. I will not be brought under the power of anything. Rather, let the power of God change my life. The first, of course, as spoken is the drug addiction. People embrace this to stimulate and make them high so that they may escape the realities of this world. But they get stuck with living in it, in that world, and don't want to come back to our world. Drug addiction. They get stuck in that world. I was discussing with my wife yesterday about this message. I said, okay, if Paul said it's no longer high that do this thing, but sin that dwells in me. So I want to link and connect sin to this habitual, addictive, compulsive behavior. So this is drugs. What sin do I link to it? It's easier for me to link gambling, sport betting to greed. Because greed is fueling this. Greed is a sin. Fueling what? Gambling, sport betting, want to make more money is greed. My dad was always betting. It's lack of contentment with what God has given to you. Am I communicating? So it's easier for me to link lust of sin, sexual sin, to pornography. Pornography, sex, sexual sin. So this is a sin, this is a habit. Am I communicating? So what do you link to drug addiction? Somebody say, I want to be high. Somebody say, highness. My wife said, passion to be high. To be high. I said, what is this sin? They want to be high. High. Is that a sin of high? Say it again. Complex, not complex. Pride. Okay. That's what I say, pride. The devil also took alcohol or drug. No, it's not pride. It's not pride. It's debauchery. Go and read Galatians chapter 5. Manifestations of the works of the flesh. You'll see them there. All those sins are the works of flesh. The things we do on the outside is also what is connected to alcohol. They're the same. The children in Exodus chapter 32 says they rose up to play. It's all there. You see the works of it. They rose up to play and to dance. It's all part of pleasure. But it's that small. The poetry. Excessive things. You see excess, additions, heresies, emulations, idolatry, hatred, variance, envies, drunkenness. You can say drunkenness. So you connect those habits to one of those. These things are there, but the loss of the flesh, the pride of life, and the loss of the eyes, they are there, but they are the ones that will fuel what the habits you see. So if you can only deal with the greed, you will break this habit. If you can deal with the root, you will stop the fruits. Am I communicating? Do you get the point? Drugs. Because I've asked God, God, deliver that man from drugs. Why is he still on drugs? I know someone very close to my wife. He's in his mid-60s now, I think. He must have been under drug addiction for over 35 or 40 years. Destroyed his first family, second family. The wife left, the children are not part of him. From when he was invested in America, he just started taking it, destroyed everything. This thing called, is to destroy drug addiction. Destroys everything. Drug addiction, they can't stop it. They just put in their veins, just there. They can't, the thing just controls them. They're slaves! Slaves! And as they call them addicted. Drug addiction. Have you seen someone under drug addiction? You will pity them. You will not like them. When you see them in that state, you say, is this you? They become vegetarian. You'll be like, how did you get here? How did you get here? Addiction. Addiction. Drug addiction. Number two. Alcohol addiction. I've spoken about alcohol addiction a lot. People are coming to debate today. Why do people go and drink so much? People say, why? Why must you go? Is that 55? Why do you run to alcohol in the morning? Why? This one, I don't even understand. This one, I don't understand. They will just gather around the table eating chicken. Look at them. Chicken and the alcohol. Faji, they call it. It's also debauchery. You don't sit here. That's why I'm bothered that every year, Nigerian breweries, all those companies, they declare profit. And then we also declare souls winning. We are winning more souls. So it doesn't correlate. I don't know why. We are opening more churches. And they're also selling more. So who is buying the thing? Yeah, I don't understand. I mean, it's a mystery. It's a mystery of Lagos. Mystery of Nigeria. Only Nigeria will one be rising, another one be rising. Because one should affect one. This one should affect that one. Am I right? We're increasing in church. They are increasing in alcohol selling. So who are those drinking alcohol? Ghosts? Go and check. We are both declaring profit. They are declaring profit. We are declaring profit. That's it. I'm telling you, go and check. Our books, we are making more money. The church is growing. The church is now in trillions. Their books, they are growing. So who are those now? Do they import people to come and drink alcohol in Nigeria and then go back to Cameroon? Only Nigeria. Fuel subsidy, fuel consumption is rising. We don't have cars. We're not buying cars. We're drinking fuel. So only Nigeria. Only Nigeria. Every year our fuel consumption grows. Spending grows. Subsidy grows. Cars reducing. How? Someone does drinking the fuel. Hey! Do you see why Nigeria is a different country to live in? We are very unique. We are unique. Only in this country will churches be growing and our courses will be growing. Only in Nigeria. Go and check other countries. Our core will be growing, churches are closing. It makes sense. It's a mystery. But only in Nigeria, our core is growing. Churches are growing. They are declaring profit. We are declaring profit. It's very clear. We are the ones drinking it now. Put your hands together, everybody. Clap, clap. We are the ones drinking it. We are the market. They are not threatened by our existence. They should be threatened that if this church continues to grow, market, supermarket for us. They're not threatened. Very soon, if we begin beer at the church, now to go and begin to market. Praise God. Acquire. People run to this to escape their worries, anxieties, and they get hooked on it. This is what I hear. I don't know how true. They say they want to get out of worry, let me go and drink. Number three, porn and sex addiction. This is very bad, especially within the church movement. Because we've told you, abstain from sex. The Bible says so. Do not have premarital sex. Do not commit fornication. Do not commit adultery. So they say, but how my sexual urges, how do I contain them and curb them? So people just go to this place and do masturbation a lot. Even pastors have now said masturbation is not a sin. So you can see, they're now saying, go and do more porn. If a pastor cannot say masturbation is not a sin. So you just see, because we have more born again Christians, and if you check Nigeria, I don't know the statistics. I'm sure if you want to check it, like alcohol, maybe it's not, it's rising. It's not rising. It's not angels that masturbate to. It's human beings. And they are addicted, addicted. To the point that many people have many things called sex toys. They are plenty on the streets. It's an addiction. Where the thing is controlling you. You are under the power of it. You are a slave to it. A slave. S-L-A-V-E. Slave with pleasure. Is there? People do this to feel pleasure and don't know how to stop even when it's not pleasant anymore. They become slaves to the things that are meant to make them happy. Number four, gambling and sport betting. My townsman made billions from it. How they will not sue me? They call him a badger. I shut off my mic. Off my mic. They said, off your mic, off your mic. To the point where pastors are praying for you to go and do sport betting. They bring you to church, pastor, please pray that I will win. An addiction. You are praying over an addiction, the power of God, not to break it, but to enable it. Do you know what you are saying? The Holy Ghost, the anointing to enable this act. Greed. You must be reading another Bible. You must be reading another. Sport betting. If you see how people do it, you'll be shocked. Every corner, haven't you seen them? Everywhere. People that are hungry, they have no school fees, they will take their school fees to go and do sport betting. What is failing it? Greed. Housewife will take money. House husband, whatever they call themselves. Are you not aware that we now have house husbands? You don't know. The women are the ones doing the work. The man is at home. Is house husband. House husband is taking the money. The breadwinner wife is giving to him to help keep the home. House husband take it to go and do sport bet. House husband, shameless man. Wife goes to work in the morning, comes back at night, gives you money to keep the home. You take it to go and do. If you see the hope people have in this thing, the way they pray, when they go for vigil, this is prayer they're praying. You know? Let me win, 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 let me blow, let blow, let blow, let blow. You want to blow? Hey! Sport betting. People are all watching me and laughing. You don't know what I'm saying now. You know what I'm saying. I don't want to look at you. Don't Don't look straight. I'm not talking to you. Don't let them know you do it. Just pretend. Just you to be laughing. Say, so they won't know that you're what you're doing. Because if you don't laugh, they'll be suspecting you. So you to laugh, so they will suspect you. Spot betting. It's everywhere. Discipline yourself, be in control. My income and what I spend it on. My family, my church, my God, myself. Spot betting. I can't. To fail what? To win what? I'm not winning, so I'm winning what? It's an addiction. Social media. No, I know you don't believe this. Off the mic. I should off the mic. I will off the... This one is an addiction today. I fell victim to this one day. I was in America and they took light. They normally take light. I think there was a storm in our place and the light went off and our internet went down. If you see the way I was behaving, like I would die. I call my son, Joshua, no internet. Joshua, what do we do? Joshua, Daddy, take it easy. No, no. I said, he told me, he said, Dad, can't you do without internet for one day? You want to kill me? I told my son, you want to kill me? I should live for one day without internet. You want to kill me? Then the Holy Ghost rebuked me. That son, are you saying you cannot do without Wi-Fi for one day? I said, Lord, you know I don't know how to lie. I cannot do, but help me. Help my own belief. I began to say to myself, am I addicted? Some of us are just so social media. Some people here cannot do without this thing. Even in church, in your service, 2 hour service. In service. Service is going on. They're doing praise worship. It's not SME. It's not SME. I shut off the mic. I shut off the mic. Choir. They are singing in a choir. I wonder if it is God you are worshiping or you are doing. Let them see me. They say they are creating content. I know you are creating content for your addiction. I know. For your addiction. I know you are creating content for your addiction. I shut off the mic. Some women are addicted to this thing. Young ladies are addicted to it. Very bad. People started by liking the idea of being liked. You started by liking the idea of being liked and followed. But soon discovered that their lives are boxed into a fake world that they don't want to live. They will do anything to be on social media. And the day your likes reduce, you become moody. You become depressed. You become sad. You come to commit suicide. Why? They didn't like my post. Who are they? They don't like my post. It affects you. It affects you. You're afflicted because you're addicted. You can't think straight. Number 6. Video games. There was a young man. There was a young man who was in his 30s who does video game as if his life would break his wife's head just for video game. Like, I don't know what the drive from it. Hours. A young man in his 30s, the wife came to report him to me. We're saying 6-7 hours every day, just sitting on it. What? So I had to ask him many years ago. I asked, I said, come, tell me how it works. What are you getting from it? I told her, if I'm doing it, don't come. Fight his wife, not eat. They will not talk because of this. I said, wife is just asking, can we spend 1 hour moment together as husband and, you know, video game? I said, are you married to video game? I said, I don't mind. If you want to go there, that go. This thing. P.S. Married man. P.S. It's your new wife. P.S. They are very addictive and some people don't feel good without playing the game. They don't feel good. They have to play. This thing, very addictive. This thing, if you see people that love it, they're addicted to it. There's an addiction. They just want to... They the thing controls them. They leave church to quickly go home for video game. They leave events. I'm going to do something. It's a lie, video game. They will run on the motor. They will do okada. They get up. Like they just drink cold water. It's an addiction. Finally, this is very killing, painkillers. Some people, small headache, painkiller. Small headache, painkiller. No headache, painkiller. Even when they have nothing, they'll say, I'm having nothing. Something is wrong with me for having nothing. Give me Panadol. They just have to take, they are bothered that they're having nothing. So let me take the painkiller in advance before the thing comes. I'm telling you, painkillers. So people, that's why, and it kills them, damages their liver. Just addicted to it. Even without pain, you want to kill it. It's supposed to be painkiller. There's no pain. You're wondering why you have no pain. So you want to kill the fact that you have no painkiller. I will stop here. These are the seven things. The negative, I have some good things here. My time is up. Television, drugs, gambling, many things. You see? Gentlemen, do you agree with them? Football is football and addiction. Football is nothing. It's just Chelsea, it's just Premier League and Champions League. Yeah, it's nothing. Football. We are not addicted to it. No. It's not Premier League. We are not addicted to it. It's just fun. It's just pleasure. It's just sit. When we are watching it, women should not disturb us. For the first time in my life, my choir is, they are preaching a message to me. They are telling me football. You have omitted football. Frankly, I have not added football because I didn't think it was an addiction. It is. Okay, I submit to popular consensus. Number 8, food. Put your hands together for Jesus. It is true. Some people are addicted to football. That's right. They are very much addicted. Thank God for people like Pastor Pedro who support Enyimba. Because if you support a team like my own, you'll be sad throughout the season. I've never had the kind of calamity in that season. There was no day I was not sad because they would beat us black and blue. And I would say, what kind of team is this road long? And my wife would call me from Abuja. I said, thank you. And I won't be able to sleep. And now, you know, you'll be talking to yourself. What kind of coach is this nonsense? A man of God talking to himself, looking at the mirror because your team lost. The thing will so much influence me. I'm like, I will break this. This has to stop in Jesus' name. And then I will not watch anymore. The next game. When is the next game? They are watching again. Praise the Lord. Put your hands together for Jesus.
Thank you for listening.